Great. Thanks again, everybody, so much for joining us today. It's wonderful to come here today, especially under such challenging times. I'm Michael Morrissey. I'm the co-founder of MuckRock. I'm joined today by Freddie Martinez of Open the Government. He's a policy analyst there and frequent collaborator. And then Beryl Lipton, our senior reporter at MuckRock. We've all been digging into these issues for a long time and learned from a lot from terms of how challenging it can be to find transparency within our policing infrastructure. And so one of the things we wanted to do today was sort of share lessons we've learned and sort of figure out what can we do to kind of, as a community, build more transparent, equitable policing practices. So each of us is going to kind of spend some time talking through sort of what we've seen work and hopefully answer the questions you have about filing public records requests, as well as other resources that are already open out there that you can take advantage of as you're trying to better understand policing. We're gonna start today's presentation off with Beryl Lipton, our projects editor, and I will let Beryl take it away.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am very excited to be here to talk with you about how we can be using public records for increasing police accountability. And I'm going to start with a sort of crash course in the Freedom of Information Act and public records laws, and then break down a few different requests that individuals could start submitting today or that they could have submitted through MuckRock, and I'll talk more about how you can do that later on. So to begin, we're here to talk about the Freedom of Information Act. You can also call that FOIA for short. And generally, this applies to the federal public records law, but also you can use it to reference just the general concept of public records. Every state has its own public records law. And as noted on the slide, public records laws and the Freedom of Information Act grant people, the public, access to records. And there are a few caveats with that. Each law has variations, and so there will be different records that you might be able to request in one state or in one jurisdiction that you might not be able to get in another state or jurisdiction. And also there are a few different ways that agencies can exempt records or otherwise redact records. These laws apply to the requests for documents, for records. So you can't just submit an open-ended question. You do have to ask for something relatively specific. So state public records laws, just a brief overview. They go by a variety of names. Some agencies or people will give you trouble if you say, I used Minnesota's FOIA law. It doesn't really matter, except that in the actual body of the request that you make, you do want to cite the proper law. Generally, all of these laws reflect the spirit of the federal FOIA. And the spirit of that law is that this is a democracy. The people of the country are supposed to be participating, and the records of the government are the people's records, because those are what we are all supposed to be using to inform our decisions and create better policy and actually get this thing to work. However, there's great variation from state to state. There are variations when it comes to the fees that different agencies can apply. So you can request records, but also agencies can request that you pay some amount of money for redaction or review or to provide actual physical copies of these records. Exemptions will vary from state to state. So what you might be able to get, as I mentioned, in one state, for example, police personnel records, you might not be able to get in another state. And so that's something to keep in mind. And on the local level, sometimes agencies can get a little creative with the exemptions that they apply. So always be aware that, one, it is your right to be requesting these records, and approach them with the idea that you deserve a response. And if you are not getting a full response, that the agency is supposed to be citing some reason why you are not getting your full response. Okay, so a few basics before I jump into sort of how you might frame a request or what you might get through a request. One, I know that you know, there are a lot of emotions involved with engaging with the government. But something to remember when you're asking for these records is that the frontline person who often receives these requests is, you know, often an office worker. And so generally, as in any situation, start off kind, because FOIA officers are people too. And often they are the people that you are using to interface with the rest of the agency. And so it's good to not out of the gate come out too aggressive. I would like to discourage anybody from maybe thinking that they could submit 100 requests all at once to an agency or otherwise sort of overload an agency with questions. There are provisions in each of the state laws that would allow an agency to reasonably reject you at that point. And so try to keep in mind that this is sort of a mechanism similar to checking something out of the library or something else like that. But obviously also keep in mind, this is your right. Do not be afraid to use it. This is exactly what we're supposed to be doing in a democracy. And even though there are going to be some agencies that consider it a little aggressive for you to be asking them at all what it is that they are doing, that is absolutely what you are supposed to be doing. So always keep in mind that you are well within your rights to be asking these questions and to be demanding these records. Great. So with a bit of that background, what FOIA is able to do is help you address some of your questions and get answers and data points that have been collected by the government to address those questions. And so while you're not exactly able to ask straight up a question, you know, what is it that you do about uses of force? You can ask for specific records like, what is your use of force policy? And so we're going to talk about a few ways to do a little bit of background research before you actually submit your request. Generally, what we recommend is that you consider what a middle manager would do. So that is, who is handling these records? How might they be organizing them? And what are the other processes in place that might help you frame your question? Because the government is a bureaucracy, bureaucracies love to keep records, and there are a lot of reporting requirements already in place that don't necessarily get fulfilled, but are there and which you can follow up on. So a few of those examples here, mandatory reporting. If there is some sort of report or other data set that an agency or a police department is supposed to be keeping, you can request that information. And that should be relatively straightforward because you can point to a mandatory reporting requirement. Similarly, procedure and process records. So things related to policies, to the actual protocols that an agency is supposed to follow, internal documentation along those lines, in order to be executing some of these programs would be public record, and that's something that you can get and sort of think through what that paper trail might look like when there is a very, very sketchy program in place. Also, if a government actor has mentioned a program in public, either in a press release or in a press conference, or otherwise referenced it some other way on Twitter, you can use that to frame your public records requests. So that's very important because, you know, people will sometimes pay lip service to certain accountability measures and they might not follow up on them. So to be able to point to Mayor so-and-so saying on this day that he would do X, Y, and Z thing is very helpful when asking for records about how he actually implemented that. And then a final sort of note, consider which other agencies are going to be involved in any particular action. So as we're seeing right now in a lot of the protest activity, there are a lot of different policing agencies that are involved, and we might wanna consider how they are collaborating with one another, how they're communicating, and what sort of resources different agencies have to get from one another in order to be doing the sorts of things that they are doing. Great, so, additional resources for sort of figuring out.
No worries.
Additional resources for sort of figuring out what might actually be in a particular agency's filing cabinets and how you might request those. One, consider the agency's own website. Often agencies will put up information, open data sets, different policies, press releases, obviously, and a few other things part of their regular operations. And you can use that information to sort of ask and point for different data sets. So if you see that a particular agency puts up some number that's supposed to reflect the number of use of force incidents in a particular time frame, then you can sort of know that they have a going data set of the incidents, those of details related to those incidents, and then you can ask for that information. And so you can start piecing together these different pieces. As I mentioned, public meeting notes, press releases, public statements, anything that was either presented to city council or to the state or in other different reporting areas often has a sort of web of other records and materials related to it, and those are generally public record. Also, consider looking at the index of different agencies' records. So each agency generally has a records retention schedule. Agencies are often required to keep records for a certain period of time before they are permitted by regular archival laws to delete them. And so if you look at the state records retention schedule and then often the agency's own specific records retention schedule or records index, you can get a sense of the types of records that they are supposed to have and also for how long they're supposed to keep them, which can also be useful if you find out that an agency has deleted particular records out of line with the legal requirements. I would also recommend that you check out Muckrock requests. So if you go on muckrock.com, you can search through the requests that have been filed through our site by agency, by jurisdiction. You can look at different keywords. And so you can get a bit of a sense of how agencies respond, what records they've previously provided, different language that people have used to get some of these records. And that can be a really good resource to see what has worked, what hasn't worked, and what sorts of materials are already out there. So you can use those to build your research. Also consider looking at Document Cloud, which is where we host all of our materials, is part of our organization, and which also hosts PDFs from a number of other journalists and researchers. FOIA Mapper, another site that looks at the different FOIA agencies and laws. Google, of course, news articles, and the book Art of Access is a good reference for understanding generally different public records laws in different states. Great, so some request basics. In your request, you definitely want to cite the law. Sometimes it's not absolutely necessary, but if you actually want to be able to take action on your request, you should absolutely cite the proper state law. You also want to be specific. Agencies can request you for not being specific enough. So if I were to say, I want all of the emails sent to your agency for the last 10 years, that is probably going to be a relatively burdensome request for an agency, and they're probably going to ask that you reduce the scope of it because they practically would not be able to get through all of those emails. Now, sometimes that's actually not true, and they do actually have the technological capabilities of doing that sort of email search. But in general, you do want to keep your requests relatively specific. Ask for documents, don't ask questions, and try to provide as much detail as possible. So it's always going to be more effective if you can say, I specifically want this form, which I know that you keep for this reason. That's going to be more effective than saying, I want any forms that you happen to fill out on this particular program, although that sort of request might also be effective. And also note that they have to respond to you. They have to acknowledge your request. Every records law has some time frame in which an agency is supposed to provide you an acknowledgement, and generally some reason either that they can't provide the records or that they can't provide the records right now. So definitely follow up. That's one of the easiest ways that agencies can get away with not providing records in accordance with the law is by simply just not responding. Don't let them do that. Okay. So a few things to keep in mind. You do not need to explain why you're requesting. So if you submit a request for use of force policies and the agency says, well, I'm not going to respond just yet because I don't understand what you're going to use this for, that's not legal. You do not have to respond to that. They just need to process your request. So there might be ways that the agency could try to slow your response. Be aware of them and don't let them do that. If you get a response, be sure to interrogate it. Check out what is there and what's not there. Compare it to what you sort of expected there to be, and follow up with the agency if you expected there to be more or if you were absolutely certain that there should have been material that was not provided. Follow up on exemptions. Sometimes agencies will just willy-nilly cite exemptions, thinking that you're not going to actually look at what that part of the law says. Don't let them do that. Follow up on the exemptions. Make them actually cite what it is that is keeping you from the information that you need. And on the state level, oftentimes there is some sort of administrative appeal option. Always consider submitting an appeal, even if you feel that you maybe have gotten all of the materials that there actually are. Sometimes, either through negligence or through by accident, agencies will leave out records or not conduct a full search. And so in those cases, and in almost all cases, you want to say, I don't quite trust what you've done here. Could you conduct another search or otherwise appeal? And a few things to keep in mind. We have submitted a lot of these requests, and I know that there, again, are a lot of emotions that sometimes go into the act of asking a question. So one, don't cite every possible law. If you are not sure what the law is in your state, MuckRock has a handy guide that we'll provide a link for in a minute. Just cite the state law that is applicable. Two, you don't need to include extraneous arguments. You don't need to include reasons necessarily for why you feel emotionally compelled to submit this request. Do include reasons why you believe that your materials should be released and exist and are in the public interest, but don't necessarily include a whole sort of journal entry about the importance of what you're doing here. Also, don't bury your request in legalese. It's not necessary. Often it doesn't help. It's just not necessary. And finally, don't forget that there's a human on the other side of the process. And so do the best that you can to craft a good request, but also sort of expect that there might be some back and forth and that you might have to talk or engage with a human and more clearly explain what it is that you're trying to get. Okay. So those are sort of the basics of what you might want to include in a FOIA request and what you might expect from one. And I'm going to just go through a few requests that you could submit very easily and really expect that you deserve a response in a reasonable time frame. Standard procedures and policies. For a police department, there is always going to be some standard manual of the policies by which they are supposed to act. And so requesting these should be a relatively straightforward process. Sometimes agencies or police departments will put these materials online. However, often they don't necessarily put all of the policies that they have. And so requesting their standard operating procedures or their policy manual can often be a very good starting point for understanding what it is, what the world is of police policies and what they are supposed to be tracking for themselves. Those are the standards by which they hold themselves. And so it's a very, very good starting step when you're trying to understand a police department. blank forms. This is a point that I just like to shout out Dave Moss from the Electronic Frontier Foundation. Blank forms can be very useful when you are trying to build your strategy for figuring out what an agency has or what it is you're trying to get. Sometimes it can be difficult, for example, if one wanted all of the forms related to use of force incidents, it might be difficult to either ask for that information because you don't know the structure in which it's kept, or there just might be other complications in terms of understanding how it is the information is stored. So if you ask for the blank forms, that sort of gives you a foundation from which you can be requesting other materials. You can say, I want exactly this form when it's filled out, or you could say, I want the aggregate information from all of these types of forms, et cetera. So blank forms are another great thing that you could easily request and expect that you should be getting a comprehensive response. Contracts and spending. Contracts and spending is one of the I think most fruitful areas that you can find information about what police departments are doing, because that is where contracts are, where they're building their partnerships, and it's where also where they're doing their equipment acquisition. So for example, if you're talking about facial recognition, and maybe Freddie will talk more about this in a bit, but if you would like to know what an agency is using for facial recognition, what they've spent on it, you know, who they've received marking materials from, et cetera, asking for their contracts or asking for their spending, their invoices, their procurement materials in general, that can be very, very good information. And that's information that should absolutely be public record. The contract is being entered into by the police department, theoretically on behalf of the people, and similarly, the spending that they're conducting is taxpayer money, and so you should expect that if you ask for their spending on a particular technology or in a particular area, you should get those receipts. You deserve them. It's the law. Use of force policies. So there's been a lot of conversation around use of force policies. It is a subset of the other policy manual that I was talking about. And use of force policies, as we know, can be a really important leverage point in terms of holding police accountable when they actually do use force. If something is mentioned in their policy and they violate that policy, that obviously creates stronger ground for other punitive action, you know, because that was those were the standards they said that they would uphold. So requesting use of force policies, highly recommended. Oh, I must have left one out. The other document that I want to mention are police union contracts. Like other contracts, those should be public records. Sometimes there are reasons within the contract that are arguably legal that prevent those materials from being released. Nonetheless, you should be able to request and get them. So I would definitely include that as a top level And then finally, I would like to mention that we really would love to help everyone get started requesting these materials and also building some of these databases. So if you go to www.muckrock.com/assignment, you will find a couple of different forms through which you can submit either your local police department or your local county or city. And we will submit a request for that police department's use of force policy. And there's another assignment there related to police department misconduct settlements and the amount of money that's being spent on police lawsuits. So if you really would like to take action now and you maybe aren't comfortable at the moment submitting your own request, simply go to that URL, submit the location, and we will handle the rest for you. Thank you so much, guys, for joining. I'll pass it off to Freddie.
Hello. There you go. Thank you. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about some of my our experiences under trying to get misconduct records under FOIA and similar state laws. So by Michael's slide, please. Maybe there you go. So by default, many states and many cities do not make misconduct records public. So for example, here in the District of Columbia, they're not public. 23 state laws make them public for a variety of reasons. In some states, they are considered part of a personnel record and therefore private. In other states, it's just prohibited by the state law. Other parts of the country, it's maybe not against the state law, but some cities might have it in something like a union contract. Like Beryl mentioned, you know, that might be a reason to go look at union contracts. And so a lot of the kinds of records of misconduct that people are interested in are not public, and that doesn't mean that you should not be discouraged by this. There are lots of different tips and tricks for building getting misconduct records, and we'll talk about some of that in a second. The first part is that there have been a variety of do-it-yourself databases being built around the country. Many cities and states require there's a federal criminal rule of procedure that if there are officers who, for example, have a long history of misconduct, prosecutors won't call them to the stand. And these kinds of disclosures are sometimes called Brady or Giglio disclosure. I'm not a lawyer. So these kinds of lists exist where prosecutors will have lists of officers that they just won't call. And so sometimes people have been building out their own lists, defense attorney offices have been building out databases where they keep track of the misconduct record. Or another common thing is that the particular officer's misconduct records might not be releasable under FOIA, but they are releasable to a defense attorney who asks for them. So I know that there are groups like Legal Aid Society in New York that then take those records and build their own kinds of accountability projects. Another thing to be aware of is that in some cities, if an officer is being investigated for misconduct, they are assigned into particular police units. And so you can routinely look in, you know, a particular assignment to see if that which officers have been stripped of police duty. So even if you can't get it through, let's say, public records law, you might be able to get it because it's considered a personnel record. You might be able to learn something about a particular officer that way. Another thing to be aware of is that you might not be able to get it from a police department, particular misconduct records from a police department, but you can get them from other departments. So there are life cycles of complaints. One of the things that's nice about most public records laws is that they apply to anyone who might possess a copy of a record and not just the originating agency. So even if a police department won't give you a misconduct record, if they, for example, hand it off to a citizen review board and that citizen review board is subject to public records laws and they have a copy of the record, you might be able to obtain a copy of it. And so this is true for places like Illinois, where you have jurisdictions where the police department routinely refuses to give up misconduct records, and you can still obtain them from the oversight board, the police oversight board. So be aware that you know, if you can understand the life cycle of the complaint going from the police department to the citizen review board, to maybe the mayor's office, who ultimately would sign off on any action. Understanding that life cycle means that you do have a chance to obtain the records, even if the state law makes it challenging to do so. There are additional challenges. Usually, investigative bodies like a citizen review board will, you know, look at the records, and they have a set certain number of months by which they have to complete their investigation. Oftentimes you find that those records are called investigative records, and they will say that they, you know, a citizen review board or mayor's office will say that we can't release these records because it would endanger the objectivity of the investigation. So be aware that that is a very common tactic, and it's a thing that you might get often. There are also challenges of overlapping jurisdiction. So in many cases I've seen where we've wanted to request records on an officer who's being investigated, and the mayor's office will say, well, we can't release those records because the FBI is also investigating this officer, and we don't want to jeopardize the FBI's investigation. This happens a lot, so be aware that you might have these overlapping jurisdictional issues. That doesn't mean that records will not be releasable, but just be aware that this is an issue, a very common issue. Be aware that there are different types of misconduct. So in Chicago, where I'm originally from, it would be a lot easier to strip a police officer of their police powers for what are called, you know, rule violations. They didn't wear the uniform properly than it would be for racial or verbal discrimination. So when you're looking at a set of records or looking for misconduct records, you might want to know that, because it allows you to look for different types of misconducts and understand really what are the forces at play here in the city or the state that are allowing, you know, some officers to walk out the front door, but others are on desk duty, and it's, you know, because of a uniform violation type thing. Another challenge with misconduct records is the fact that data can be unstructured or can change over time. So often you'll get records back from a police department in a way that is not helpful. You might have to analyze a record yourself. You might need maybe help from a computer programmer or something. The data can change over time. And that can also be another challenge. Michael, I'm not sure if I have one more slide, but if not, I can switch topics quickly. Yeah, okay, maybe we can slide back for a second. The other thing I want to say is that just because, you know, you can't understand in particular police officer misconduct records, that doesn't mean that you can't build profiles of what other kinds of misconduct. So for example, you can investigate overtime reports at an agency and see if for example, in Boston, there was a report that came out last week that the top five paid people in Boston across the city are police officers, with one pulling in something like $250,000, much of that in overtime. You know, that can be a type of misconduct, a different type of waste, fraud, or abuse that you might be interested in learning more about. You can investigate disparate impacts, so things like stops and searches and search warrants and where they're being executed. A lot of records that should be already public that you can find, you can look on a city's website, you can see that, you know, maybe you can understand how they're saving the search warrant data, put in a public records request and see, you know, how often are they searching, you know, minority communities versus white communities and things like that. So Beryl kind of alluded to it earlier. You can look at the misconduct settlements and lawsuits that are being settled by the city. How much are they paying lawyers? Those are different types of misconduct that you can get from public records as well. So that is just to say that while it might be challenging to provide independent oversight, it's not impossible. There have been a lot of really successful projects out there that have really succeeded. It is a challenge, but we encourage you to use FOIA to begin sort of taking a stab at it. Someone just asked, where would you look for settlement statements? typically there are, those are approved either by city budgets or by, you can also look in, like, for example, when cities have to pay lawyers for police misconduct settlements, usually it might, that might be in there as well. But in most cities, misconduct settlements are either, they're usually voted on by like the city council. I know, I think it's the case in Chicago. I think it's the case in other cities. So some of that information is already public record, but you would have to sort of link that with other kinds of misconduct records, like maybe a use of force, excessive force type thing. Yeah, okay, that's what I have. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Freddie. So I just wanted to kind of follow up, and both Freddie and Beryl touched on this topic and their things, but sort of the economics of policing just real briefly. And we, just as a side note, I forgot to mention at the top that we've posted a lot of links and related resources is sort of the top article at muckrock.com right now. And so some folks were asking about sort of settlement documents and then all of the different types of requests that Beryl mentioned. We have examples of those requests at Muckrock where you can actually see the language and kind of see how those requests are structured and sort of successful examples of folks who have filed those. Also, just a note, so many amazing questions. Please keep those coming in. And we're looking forward to answering them in just a few more slides. So thank you for those. So kind of a truism within journalism, sort of follow the money to kind of figure out sort of what's going on within an agency or within an action. I think one of the things that almost every state feels very strongly on is sort of people have a right to understand how tax dollars are being spent. And that means that even if an agency says, oh, this is a secret program, or oh, you don't have the right to this because it's an ongoing investigation. When money is spent, it's very hard for agencies to hide that. And that can be really useful for a requester. And I think there's also the quote that a budget is a moral document, right? So a budget, when an agency puts together a budget, that's not just sort of numbers in a void, but that actually tells you what that agency or even what that city's priorities are as a collective. And so paying very close to budgetary documents, to contracts, is really, really helpful. So for example, I think it's really important to kind of take a look and sort of see how are police departments spending their money. So a few, one ongoing thing we've dug into is sort of how much are agencies spending on sort of riot gear, for example. One thing we've discovered about police departments over the years is that it's, they, in their perspective, they like buying fun new toys. And so if there is a grenade launcher that launches tear gas, if there are drones, if there is an assault vehicle that they can find some sort of justification for, a lot of times they get really excited by that and they'll buy it and they'll kind of really push a justification. And we've actually seen emails for this where it's like, oh, this is so cool. We need to find a way to kind of get this. And so you'll see sort of small towns that are not having a whole lot of incidents where they'll just start buying up equipment because they went to a conference and they saw a neighboring police department had this gear and they want to get a copy of it themselves. So just paying attention and filing requests for budgets and sort of looking at sort of, hey, have you put in a budget request for this? And as we've seen recently, there's a big push to kind of the defund the police movement. And, you know, I think people in a vacuum kind of say, well, why would we defund the police? We need a policing force. But I think it's, you quickly can look at these budgets and sort of start asking questions like, why does a school-focused police department need grenade launchers and that sort of thing, which is an actual expenditure we found in the past. And so we filed this request for budgets on riot gears in 2017 with a bunch of different departments. And it was a fairly simple request. And we asked for budgeting financial data, looking at these kinds of expenses. How much are agencies spending on tear gear, tear gas, smoke grenades, chemical munitions launchers? And what we found is that agencies just kind of buy this stuff because it's something fun, it's something new, and it's something different. But once you start buying up this equipment, not only are you spending tons and tons of money, but then over time you find justifications for its use. So how agencies spend their money, what equipment they invest in upfront, almost always comes back with real policy and real world implications, right? If agencies hadn't been stocking up on riot gear for the past decade, I think we'd have much different picture across America. So look at how police departments are spending their money as sort of the first sort of economic angle to look at. I also want to emphasize looking at police settlements. So somebody asked for where would you look for settlement statements? And we'll, I think there's a link on that resource page I mentioned earlier to a request for police settlements, but that's just a very standard request. I want a copy of any police settlements with the agencies made over the past year stemming from police misconduct claims or other claims, legal claims against the department. And what we found is that agencies are just paying hundreds of thousands or millions of dollars for all these claims. And a lot of times they'll make the claimant sign a non-disclosure agreement, and that keeps these claims secret. But those non-disclosure agreements do not trump public records laws. And so you've got this list, and sometimes there's a fair amount of detail in there. Or if there's not a lot of detail, you can see some really eye-popping numbers, which indicates problems that because the victim was sort of said, hey, we'll give you $1 million, but you have to promise never to talk to the press about this. That's never going to come out unless somebody goes in, requests that settlement data, and takes a look at it. So the first thing is just look at how police departments are spending their money. Another thing that's important to look from is sort of how are police departments getting their money? One of the things that Lucy Parsons Labs in Chicago, which Freddie works with, one of the things that was really eye-opening was sort of all these police departments around America have sort of found a way to kind of create these sort of black budgets that are really kind of hidden from disclosure with city councils, right? And so what happens is under asset forfeiture programs around the country, local police departments can seize anything that they can allege was sort of used in a criminal operation. And then if that person is not able to prove that that money or that car or whatever it was not used for committing the commission of a crime, then that police department then just gets to keep that money. And so what we found was that a lot of the sort of most serious surveillance equipment, a lot of sort of military gear, a lot of sort of really, when we think of militarized policing, a lot of that came from asset forfeiture programs because there was very little oversight over these programs. And in states that sort of passed rules limiting asset forfeiture, what we found was local police departments oftentimes signed agreements with the federal government saying, hey, we by law are not allowed to do asset forfeiture in our state, but the federal government still can take advantage of asset forfeiture. And so it was almost a bounty program where the federal government would essentially deputize local police departments to seize money and equipment and cars and electronics allegedly used in crimes, and then split the money with the local police department and the federal police department. So they're actually skirting local legislature's intent by sort of creating deals with the federal government. And one of the important things to know is that a lot of times these people, there's not a lot of evidence there, but if you are a low-income individual and you can't afford a good lawyer, it's really hard to kind of go to court and prove that you weren't committing a crime, right? It's not innocent until proven guilty. With asset forfeiture, it's generally guilty until proven innocent, and you really need to go in and make a really tough argument to get those funds, to get that vehicle, to get that house in some cases released. And not only is this fueling sort of more policing, and not only is this deeply unfair to a lot of the individuals that have had their assets seized, but then that creates a really unaccountable budget in police departments around the country. So don't just look at sort of how police departments are spending their money, but also look at how they're making their money. One of the other things that's become really, really problematic with policing around the country is sort of how fines and fees are used to kind of backfill city budgets, right? I think we see this again and again where local departments become really dependent on sort of parking tickets or aggressive enforcement of various statutes where we've seen some police departments where 30% of their budget, 40% of their budget comes from fines and fees. And while quota systems are technically illegal, There's still a lot of police departments where it's very clear that if you want to advance, if you want to keep your job, you need to be out there ticketing people. You need to be out there finding crimes. And then law enforcement's job becomes not just sort of stopping crime or deterring crime, but really making sure that they can continue to produce crime. And so they criminalize sort of everyday activities. You see loitering fines. You see all sorts of different opportunities for the police departments to kind of criminalize just daily activity because they need to make these quotas, because they need to keep this revenue source. So it's very important to kind of go in and sort of look at who is actually funding your police department and sort of what can you do to kind of say, actually, maybe we should fund government services through taxes that we as a collective have agreed on, rather than sort of creating these sort of backdoor budgets to creative things. And then finally, so I think it's important to look at where police departments spend their money. And I think it's important to look at where police departments get their money. But I also think we oftentimes miss how oftentimes police departments avoid financial transactions at all and go for off the books grants. So a few years ago, we methodically went to every state and we got their 1033 data. So local police departments were basically getting free military gear that was coming back from overseas. And because they weren't spending money on the gear, they just had to promise to take care of it. Local town councils and everything didn't actually know that tanks and grenade launchers and all sorts of really crazy tooling was coming into their local departments that the police departments weren't even paying for. And for a lot of departments, they treated it like Christmas, right? They're getting all these cool new goodies, they're all these new toys, and they don't have to tell anybody about it. They just have to promise to do a little bit of training, which a lot of departments never even did that. And all of a sudden, we saw all this military gear kind of flowing into local police departments all around the country. And it was sort of college cops. It was all sorts of things where it's like, you take a look at sort of these expenditures and you're like, why on earth would this town of 2,000 people need an assault vehicle, right? Why do we need so many grenade launchers at a primary school? And, you know, I think, again, once agencies start acquiring these, once departments start acquiring all this gear, it's really hard for them to sort of give it up once they're kind of used to it. And we need to look at sort of the financial incentives that have encouraged police departments to become increasingly militarized, to become stock up on this gear. And once you stock up on it because it's free, then you become dependent on it and then you start to use it. And I think that's a real challenge. So look at how money's spent, look at how money's earned, and then look at how transactions occur that don't involve money at all. And this is also true of private organizations, right? Increasingly, we've seen sort of groups make donations to police foundations so that it's technically not a government agency even that is signing some of these contracts. Recently in Baltimore, the Arnold Foundation funded an aerial surveillance program that sent drones over the city of Baltimore, but it was not subject to public review because that donation was made to the Baltimore Police Foundation, right? And so where you have these sort of pseudo-private organizations that are in control of these policies, taking away control from policymakers, taking away oversight from the public. And so as you're interested in trying to understand how policing works and sort of what's funding it, taking a look at all of these different aspects is really important. Again, just briefly want to mention that we have resources posted right now on muckrock.com. Hopefully that link is live. And then if you do end up filing requests, we do have a free chat room. You can sign up at muckrock.com/Slack. Just scroll to the bottom of that page, put in your information, and we'll invite you to the Slack. It takes us a little bit to process those requests. But if you have specific questions that we're not able to get to in this Q&A, or if you ever run into challenges where you get a request rejected or something like that, feel free to stop by the chat room. We have a lot of great FOIA nerds in there who are always happy to answer questions and provide examples of great requests. Speaking of questions, I wanted to get to the Q&A because we've had so many great questions. So I'm gonna turn off the screen share now and start fielding some questions. All right, so I'm just gonna read some of these out and then Freddie and Beryl, feel free to jump in. So I think somebody had a great question. How can we figure out who has the document? So if you know some sort of document or data exists, what can somebody do to make sure they're filing that with the right place?
So, I mean, I guess the first bit is you often, especially with larger police departments, it's found, they're found online. And that sometimes it's a bit of a challenge, but usually you can find, like if it's a police department, you would just ask the thing for the police department. With smaller agencies, it's a little bit more challenging. And one thing that we didn't really describe is that oftentimes the FOIA officers, the people who are processing a request, usually have a really good sense of where the documents are stored. You're not required to like tell them why, what you're looking for or why you're looking for it. But often if you get on the phone and talk to them about, you know, just like have a conversation with them, they actually might be able to direct you to the right place. So they might say, oh, well, this has happened to me multiple times where I've put in a request in a small police department and they said, oh, that person is actually with the county. Send your request to the county. And it really is just a little bit of back and forth with on the phone. So I would say that those two tips have really helped quite a bit in my searching for records.
Great. So somebody asked, the U.S. Capitol Police Department is not subject to FOIA because it is covered under the legislative branch. Is there a way around this? That's a really good question. So just in general, FOIA does apply to sort of most bodies, but Congress is exempt, the executive branch is exempt, and in most states, the judicial branch is exempt. If you're interested at the state level, which agencies are and are not subject, you can go to muckrock.com/place, and we've got a handy map that kind of breaks down some of those aspects. But if you're interested in an agency that is exempt from public records law, not all hope is lost. So one of the things you can do is sort of look at where does that agency intersect with other agencies, right? So a lot of times U.S. Capitol Police might coordinate with other agencies that are not subject to that are subject to public records law, right? And so if the mayor starts yelling at the Capitol Police, you can file a request for emails between the mayor's office and the Capitol Police Department, right? So I think a lot of the success in public records can really come from sort of triangulation, sort of looking for intersection points, right? Sometimes that can be an impediment, as Freddie mentioned, where if one agency has an ongoing investigation, the other agency might use that as an excuse. But most of the time, what we've found is that if two agencies have a document, one agency might care about that document a lot more than the other. And so the other one's happy to throw the first agency under the bus. So be thinking about when agencies intersect, be thinking about other times where sort of that veil of secrecy might come down. So a lot of times court records can provide a really valuable insight. So if something goes to trial, see what documents get filed along with that. Directly, the US Capitol Police is exempt. There is some legislative efforts to kind of get that changed, which I think we might see some pickup on over the next year or two. And so do reach out to your legislator, really push for more transparency there, because I think that is something that a lot of people are noticing and becoming increasingly concerned about. Great question. So somebody asked, will agencies provide a list of all people employed by a police department, including actual police officers? Beryl, do you want to
talk about? Yeah, go ahead.
Go ahead, Freddie.
Yes, roster data is very much public. There will be times where they'll say maybe a person's name will be exempt because they're undercover, that kind of thing. We've had success in different parts of not just requesting rosters, but even like graduation photos at police academies and things like that. So you can get pretty far with some of those requests that you can make, that you might be interested in making.
Somebody had a really great clarification that I just wanted to follow up on real quick, that said that when we talk about the executive branch, that's the White House specifically that's exempt. And sort of most of the White House, there are some exemptions to that exemption, but like the president, is exempt. Some of the White House offices, such as the Office of Science, Technology, and Policy, is subject, but most of the White House is exempt. But when you start talking about sort of federal agencies, those are all subject to disclosure. And so it's just sort of right around the White House and the presidency that is exempt from disclosure. So thank you. And I don't want people to think that most federal agencies are exempt from public records law. So somebody asked, I think this is a good question that you kind of quickly run into with public records. What can we do about shady or unactionable responses? For example, I can easily imagine agencies citing COVID as a reason they don't have enough people or on hand or bandwidth to answer a given request. Anybody want to tackle that one?
Yeah, I'll jump in. So related to COVID, yes, we have absolutely seen this. Generally sort of a first line response is if you do get a shady or unactionable response, you can often administratively appeal. Generally what I would recommend is maybe try to assume that it's not quite as shady as it maybe absolutely is, and have a conversation with the agency and try to explain to them why you think that there should be more material released. However, again, you should almost always appeal. Sometimes the appeal option is not available, and so the only option from there is to file something in court. But there are sort of many different elements built into public records laws or into previous decisions made by generally the Attorney General's office in each state related to the public records law that has different ways that you can challenge some of these shady responses. So for example, in a lot of cases, an agency isn't allowed to just whole cloth reject or refuse to provide all responsive materials. You know, in a lot of different cases, they do have to very specifically redact only the lines that are exempted. And it often in those cases, they are specifically supposed to be citing an actual reason that they are withholding that information. So I guess the short answer is challenge them, and then also do a bit of background work to, bolster the case that what they are doing is not legally allowed. Freddie, do you want to hop in and add anything to that?
Yeah, I mean, generally, this is where doing your research and your homework helps. For example, I've had responses where I asked for search warrant data from the police department, and they told me they had none. And this was in Chicago. But I went back and I said, look, I know that you have search warrant data just on this face. Of course, that's absurd. But more importantly, I know where your search warrant data is saved because you file them in this court system and this court system and that court system. Did you look for records there? And they went back and did an additional search. And of course, they have tons of search warrants in Chicago. I think just doing your homework and really asking them to where they searched really does go a long way. So I always recommend as a general tip to spend more time doing your research and your homework than actually writing the FOIA itself, because that background in where records might be or where to search for records is really does pay off in the end. So.
So two other things I just want to flag that are related to that. So somebody else also asked, other than MuckRock, who else or where else can someone find a coordinated effort to get records? Duplication of efforts seems like a bad thing. So I do want to kind of also note that there's a lot of resources out there for the requester community. There's the National Freedom of Information Coalition, which has a bunch of different groups, not in every state, but most states have sort of a transparency organization. And a lot of times they'll have access to pro bono attorneys who can help advise you. And what we found is that a lot of times, if you can reach out to your local National Freedom of Information Coalition member and say, hey, this agency's denying this request in a pretty shady way, they'll be willing to sort of write a nasty letter to the agency being like, you know, a lot of legal citations. And sometimes that gets agencies to take things a little more seriously. So look for help. And there's also the Free Expression Law Network, which is a bunch of legal clinics around the country, where you have a bunch of law students who are still optimistic and innocent, and they love threatening local agencies into compliance. So I would say, as far as other organizations, National Free Information Coalition is a good group. There's a lot of sort of open policing groups. I have a bunch of those linked to in the post that we just put up. But also just looking for help out there, because what we found is a lot of lawyers really believe in this stuff, but fewer and fewer people are filing public records lawsuits at the local level. And so if you can kind of go and find an attorney to kind of help advise, a lot of people are willing. I wouldn't go to a random attorney, but I think finding references or referrals, there's some resources out there. So somebody asked, are there specific resources for navigating all the different government agencies, such as listings, summaries of what they do, or tips for researching possible agencies to target? It's my understanding that you need to specify one or more specific groups. So the more specific you can, you can't just file a request to like the government or even to a state. Sometimes you can file a request just to a town clerk and they'll forward on that request. But as we kind of talked about, doing the research and sort of making sure it gets to the right person as soon as possible is going to be helpful to you as the requester. A lot of times I think of public records requests as like a game of telephone, where like you'll get that, the request will go to the clerk will go to their manager, the manager will go to the IT department, the IT department hates the manager and the clerk, and so they just tell them this is going to take a million hours and they won't do it. The clerk doesn't realize that that person was being sarcastic. So what you want to do is sort of figure out sort of who's likely to have control of that document. So we have a database of agencies at muckrock.com/agency. I also recommend looking at records retention schedules. And a lot of times a records retention schedule will say, hey, this type of agency needs to hold on to this type of record for this long. So that can be another useful resource for kind of figuring out where to direct your request. Beryl or Freddie, do you have any other tips in sort of like figuring out which agency you should actually get your request?
Yeah, I mean, I just want to reiterate, do get on the phone. I know it's a thing that we really struggle with, and, you know, I hate the telephone, but it's one of the tips that I used to hear a lot when I was first starting out that I ignored for the first 3 years. And since I've been doing that, it really has helped, because oftentimes, you know, these people are busy, but they also have a job. And if it makes their job easier to give you information, they will. So I just want to reiterate that one point. Just if you really are confused, and you call up any agency, you know, even if it's the City Hall, and you say, hey, I want to put in a FOIA request about public health or something like that, they will be willing to help you, just because even if you don't know where to get started, because they're there for you as a resource. So I, again, just reiterate, pick up the phone. I know it's, we would prefer to send a text message, but you really do have to do it. So. Yeah.
I would just include that if you are still concerned and you do just want to get that request out, I will often include a line saying, if you are not the proper office to be handling this request, we'd really appreciate it if you would either forward or tell me which office is the proper office. So you can include that sort of language in the request itself.
Freddie, a couple people had questions about this slide. Which are the red states and which are the yellow states? What do those mean on this map?
Yeah. So the red, sorry, I should have clarified here. This was just to give a sort of an example. The red, in the red states, there are the police misconduct records are not public. In yellow, it depends. So for example, in Illinois, they are not exempt by state law, but you'll find that police unions try to shovel it into the contract. So while that may not be the case in Chicago, Illinois, it might be the case in Springfield, Illinois. So the yellow ones are, it depends. In red, it seems to be not public in any way. So hopefully, and then the ones that are not included in here, like, you know, I'm not sure. North Carolina, maybe that's a bad example. Only, I think, 13 states are required by statute to make them public.
Thank you. Somebody asked, can we FOIA video files such as body cam footage? The answer is generally speaking, yes, but that's going to vary state by state and even jurisdiction by jurisdiction. One of the things, RCFP has a really good guide to sort of each state's laws and each local jurisdiction's laws in terms of how they treat body cam footage. So check that map out. We have that link too from the resources page, but you can also just Google RCFP body cam, because that's one of the weirdest areas of public records law, because almost all public records law is at the state level, but then body cam footage is mostly at the local level. This wasn't a question, but I think a helpful follow-up for Freddie's. We're trying to figure out how to pronounce Giglio law. And those are the lists of sort of officers who are prohibited from testifying or whose testimony is considered not fully credible. So Giglio lists, Brady lists, you can actually file a request for those in some jurisdictions, and then you've got a sense of sort of cops that district attorneys and prosecutors don't trust. So thank you for that clarification. Somebody asked, how do you trace the life cycle of a complaint in any given state and city? I don't remember who was talking about that, but tracking complaints against officers, I think, was...
Yeah, that's challenging. It generally does vary by city to city. So typically, there will be a misconduct complaint that has... Typically, like when you get you file a misconduct complaint, the agency that is supposed to oversee or investigate it has to get maybe like an interview or supporting documentation within 30, 60 days, something like that. Generally, from that period of time, there is supposed to be an investigative period. So I think in Illinois or in Chicago, the investigation has to be completed within 12 months or 16 months, something like that. And then generally the referrals for, what happens afterwards, that does this officer get stripped of police duty? Do they get put on paid leave? Those are supposed to be enforced, some 6 months after that. But it does vary quite a bit. So just be aware that they're like, and each of those components would be handled by a separate, usually like the investigative body is usually not the police department. So just be aware that it might be the police department that's, strips the police officer and puts him on desk duty. Just be aware that there are multiple agencies, but usually they all have timelines, and those timelines are usually pretty clear, and they're also usually public. So if you file a misconduct complaint or you know that one was filed, you could just set your calendar to 12 months from now to see what happened to that thing.
Somebody asked, can you see a more detailed budget available through public records than is published online? How would one ask for such a thing? Want to pass on this? Yeah. So usually agencies, the budget is the budget, but I think sometimes you can ask for budget justification files. And so a lot of times agencies are like, they'll have the budget, but then they'll, when they're going to sort of legislators or they're going to sort of their department heads, they put in a more detailed budget justification. And so you can ask for copies of the budget justifications. It doesn't hurt to ask for the budgets available. There's a few years ago where there was a major case in Rhode Island where the school district was posting sort of a modified version of the school budget and was essentially lying about what their budget was. And so it took somebody's FOIA request and eventually FOIA lawsuit. And the craziest thing about this was the woman who had to sue was actually on the school board, but the rest of the school board refused to show her the budget. So there's absolutely cases where if they do post a budget online, it's not the complete budget. And there's oftentimes ancillary documents like budget justifications that are worth going after. And a lot of times, especially in those budget justifications, right, people tend to embellish. I think that's human nature of saying, oh, we really need this, or they'll kind of spin the facts. And I think that can be particularly dangerous with police departments, where they'll kind of cherry pick examples or they'll exaggerate things. And being able to have the public go in and sort of say, what, my community is not a war zone. We do not need tanks rolling down. What the heck is this person talking about? If somebody doesn't go in and ask for that, push back on that, then it's really hard, you know, for the public to have true oversight of these things. So that's a great question, a great idea. Thank you. Would police misconduct settlements generally identify the officers involved? That's a really great question. That generally varies jurisdiction to jurisdiction, I believe. Freddie?
It does, and it also, I mean, it also depends on if the officer is named as a defendant. So sometimes it will be, you know, one officer is known and plus two or three officers were on the scene who are also named in the lawsuit. So that might be a challenge. I will also say that with police misconduct records, often you will find even in press, you would find that, let's say a police officer has been accused of a crime or something like that. They sometimes, even media will not name the officer, because, you know, but they will include relevant information, like they have, you know, two misconduct complaints against them in history and one misconduct settlement. And that might be another way of, you know, increasing transparency. So they're definitely, like, looking into the court records and using that to track information is a good way for greater transparency in other forms of, you know, in other contexts. So definitely keep track of those, but it does depend.
So somebody had a question. Are there any limits on who can make a request? Does it need to be filed by a U.S. citizen or resident? Beryl, you want to take this?
Yeah. So for the federal FOIA, there aren't any residency or citizenship requirements. You could be a citizen of another country and be asking for records generally. On the state level, it varies a bit. So I threw in the chat, Tennessee, Arkansas, Alabama, Delaware, Virginia all have residency requirements, and they do require you to be a resident to expect a response to your request. Although, depending on the agency, sometimes they, as a courtesy, will fulfill your request. There are also, state by state, a few other specific guidelines. So for example, in Louisiana, you can't file a public records request if you're under the age of 18. Some states, like Pennsylvania, require you to use a particular form, but generally you should expect that you should be able to submit a request in another state. If you can get somebody from that state to file a FOIA on your behalf, I would say that's generally kosher, although where it becomes very tricky, and Michael, maybe if you want to say a little more on this, is if you are going to want to follow up or take any sort of legal action on that request, it gets a bit more complicated if you've done it through a sort of proxy.
Yeah, and just very quickly, you don't have to identify yourself when you're sending a FOIA. In most cases, in many cases, you can do it anonymously, and you can also do it as an organization. So, you know, there have been times in the past where I've been approached where someone said, I don't want to send it in my name, will you send it on my behalf? And generally, it's okay to do that. The only place where is like litigating it, and there was, so.
And actually, I see somebody else has asked about a FOIA form that has a purpose of this request, sort of relatedly. You aren't necessarily, you don't have to tell them the purpose of the request. Depending on what state you're in, I would check the state law. It's not uncommon for local agencies to sort of create their own forms, throw things on there that aren't necessary, and then expect that you fill them out. And it just might not be legal by the state standards. So yeah. I would double check.
And other times it might just be for administrative purposes. Some states treat like a request for a copy of a parking ticket like a FOIA request. And so it might just help them do administrative work. So I wouldn't overthink it.
So somebody had a partially, I mean, a related question where they asked, can a request be filed anonymously, but also is a fear of police hostility towards a requester legitimate? And I think that's worth talking about a little bit, because at the federal level, some people are like, oh, I don't want to file a request with the FBI because then they'll start watching me or whatever. And that's usually not the case, although, you know, never say never. But I do think it's important to keep in mind that if you file a public records request for somebody's emails or for files related to somebody, there is a very, very good chance, I would say majority chance, that that person is going to be aware somebody's going to forward them your request. Maybe for legitimate reasons, because the only way they have to search those emails is by having employees search their own inbox. And so if you are, you know, you're worried about a particular police officer, if you are filing a request with an agency and you've had run-ins in the past, particularly if you are somebody who's had challenges working with that department, or that department has singled you out or harassed you in the past, or if you are worried about your safety, I think those are cases where you do want to sort of figure out what sort of protections are you comfortable with. Can you find an attorney or a nonprofit group that is willing to file that request on your behalf? In some states, it might be okay to file a request under a pseudonym, because I do think that it's going to vary jurisdiction to jurisdiction, but in some cases, yes, there is retaliation for filing public records requests. Anything that can go wrong occasionally does go wrong. We've seen people get harassed. We've seen people get yelled at. We've seen litigation begin. Generally, this is a safe activity, but there are always exceptions to that. And I think, especially with police departments, and especially if you've previously had incidents with that department, I think being mindful about protecting yourself, protecting your privacy, and potentially, I generally recommend creating narrow requests. But if you're interested in sort of harassment from one specific officer, and that officer has had a problem, you know, has caused you harm or threatened you harm in the past, you know, file a request that includes that officer, but maybe doesn't name them specifically. So I want incident reports that mention anybody in this specific patrol unit, or, if you know you're interested in one person, ask for data on 10 people. So it's a little more obfuscated. So I think there are strategies to kind of mitigate that risk, but it is real. And I think especially today, it is very, very real. So be careful, be mindful, there's options out there to sort of protect your identity depending on the jurisdiction.
Yeah, and my experience has been generally most people who fulfill FOIA requests are not, you know, those individual, like beat cops are not the ones who are fulfilling your request. So generally, I've found that this is a question I get often when I talk about FOIA and policing. That has not been my experience or anyone that I've ever trained. So just be aware that it is a fairly safe activity. So I would say that from my own perspective as well.
Yeah. Somebody else pointed out, and I think this is another important thing. Never assume that your FOIA request will be kept secret, definitely not within the agency, but even publicly. Other people can file FOIA requests for your request. And so just assume that anything you write in that request can be made public at some point. One time I had the Attorney General of Montana put out a press release saying that Muckrock was trying to impede the rights of gun owners by asking for some data around gun usage. And they put our name on that press release. And this was like, we didn't know this was coming. And all of a sudden we started getting death threats because this attorney general started scoring political points on us. So just be aware that anything you put in that request might be made public, and be mindful of that. We've had so many great questions. We'll try to follow up with ones that we can't get a chance to answer today, but we just got a few more minutes left. So somebody asked, does the state dictate FOIA rules for all municipalities? In other words, can a municipality draw up its own roster of permitted access, or would the state law trump township potential restrictions?
Yeah, generally, the state law will override it. So sometimes we see the opposite, where like San Francisco has a better public records law than California does. But yeah, generally they can't claim, they can't write up their own rules that say this is exempt because we want it to be. In fact, if anything, it'll be in the pro transparency column.
Somebody asked, are not-for-profit 501c3 agencies subject to FOIA? We want Nicola.
So generally not. However, there are some state laws where if an agency is a nonprofit and gets some sort of state funding or other funding, or otherwise sort of works within a municipal or state agency, there are some circumstances where their records are public. So it does vary state to state, but generally, no, simply because something is a nonprofit doesn't make it subject to FOIA laws. FOIA laws generally only apply to government agencies. However, that doesn't mean that there aren't some records for nonprofits, particularly those that communicate with government agencies or do other work with government agencies that you wouldn't be able to get. So there are some ways to get at that material indirectly through FOIA.
Can somebody talk a little bit about requesting your own personal files or the files of somebody else with permission, or requesting the files of deceased individuals from various agencies? Anybody want to tackle that? Want me to?
Yeah, I mean, okay, so just to start off, there's a thing called the Privacy Act, which prevents other people from getting data on you. There's also, you know, regulations like hospital regulations and things like that. So just be aware that there are privacy rights that protect things like personal information. That being said, you know, you can almost always request information on yourself. Things like, let's say, arrest records or any other thing that government officials might have on you. So there are some, you know, there are some capabilities. When you request information on yourself, you either have to sign something like a Privacy Act waiver or similar, or if you request information on others, you have to get their Privacy Act waiver, and you have to include it in the request. So usually we see this a lot in the immigration context, where people who are trying to get status need to know everything that they have, that DHS or ICE has on them. And so when they do those requests, ask FOIA requests, they have to include both a FOIA request and a Privacy Act waiver in order to figure out, you know, what records ICE has on them, and use that to build their case for asylum or whatever it is. So just be aware that there is a process for that. But almost certainly, if you're requesting information on any other person, including yourself, you really should start with the Privacy Act waiver, because if not, it will just be a waste of time and energy. So just start with that off the bat, and just know that right off the bat. So you'll see things called like Privacy Act waivers / FOIA requests. You might see that a little bit. But that's generally the process, and usually, obviously, there are state laws and similar.
Well, thank you everybody so much for your time today and for your interest in this topic. It's really important. If you work at an organization that is working on criminal justice issues, on policing issues, we'd love to see if we can help you out. Our email is info@muckrock.com. I'd also like to thank our sponsors, Hacks Hackers. They made this possible. They sponsored this event. So thank you very much to them, and thank you so much, Freddie and Beryl, and thank you so much to everybody who came and asked some wonderful, wonderful questions. We will be posting a version of this recording once we make sure that there's no private data in there, back on the website, right on that article page. And thank you so much. Keep up the great work and fight for more transparency of policing.
Have a great weekend, everyone.
Yeah, thank you, everyone.
Bye-bye.